This weekend on ETV, it's the clash of the Titans as the best pilots meet in the Alliance tournament. This clash will possibly go down in history as one of the many Alliance tournaments on the internet.
Meanwhile, there are flagships to be used. Ships like the Apoc and the Raven, which have been used in previous years.
This Saturday, watch a solar fleet take on another team in a match that's being described as on Saturday.
Who knows, perhaps the Giants of Pandemic Legion may play host to the Titans of Goonswarm, making them both seem normal size.
Perhaps AAA will play Perillion for the second time in the tournament to find out the winner.
It's impossible to keep track of every match happening during the Alliance tournament, but your best chance is right here.
Looking ahead to June, all the EVE Online PvP teams will play each other several times in several combinations, probably with several winners.
And you can catch all the matches here at eveonline.com, where we'll be showing you all the matches all the time in high definition.
Catch all the constantly happening Alliance tournament. It's all here, it's all happening, constantly, always here. Thousands and thousands of hours of Alliance tournament action each.
Shut the f*** up. The hell are you doing?
Thousands and thousands of hours of Alliance tournament action, each more climactic than the last.
Constant, dizzying, 24-hour Alliance tournament.
Every explosion mattering to someone, presumably.
And you can watch it all here, all the time, forever. It will never stop. CCP will never finally decide who has won the Alliance tournament.
There's still everything to fight for, and enough is to fight for it.
So that's the EVE Online Alliance tournament. Watch the spaceship, watch it.
It's gonna move.
So that's the Alliance tournament coming up. Watch.
Watch it. Watch it. Watch it. Watch it. Watch it. Watch it.
Le Mans says we are ready. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Dylan.
Oh, yes.
Oh, here we go. Give us some Eve as well. Right, the firing has started. The Tyrannus of Bob is flying towards the middle of the field. The missiles from the Raven Navy issue of Bob have started flying across. This looks like it's first blood.
Oh yes, the Raven always seems to get its missiles off nicely.
The Eagle has also started firing.
Look at the state of the Megathron shields. It's getting pummeled.
Yeah, the Megathron is now losing its shields.
It looks like they've changed their tactics. They're going for the heart of the segment before. Yeah. It's taking its armor out as well. Let's keep an eye on this Megathron.
I think what they're trying to do is get rid of the Megathron first, whilst they've still got
the range advantage.
And the Eagle. While they've still got the Eagle and the Raven shooting at it, if they take this one down, then it's just
a battleship versus a
support cruiser.
Yeah, and it's going to be all over. Let's see whether Bob can actually do it. As I said to you before,
they've got the drones in.
As I said before, Bob like to hit hard and they like to hit fast. Bob, don't do the slugging.
The Tyrannus is down. All its shields are gone. The Megathron flown by Kozak of Chaos
is being hammered very hard.
It's down half.
But it's shield tanking quite nicely.
It's not shield tanking, you tart. It's armor tanking.
Sorry, it's armor tanking quite nicely.
So yes, it's armor tanking.
It should get in range.
But
quite
I think it's these drones that are doing most of the tanking, to be honest. He's got some maintenance drones flying around him, but I think the drones are just out. The Megatron's out of range.
Yeah, this is going to be interesting. Whether they can do enough damage to it before it gets in range, before it can start pummeling back.
Well, at the moment, it's down to half its armor, 40% of its armor. It's struggling to attack this.
They definitely need to concentrate and continue.
However, there's the Deimos. The Deimos sneaked in there. We didn't see the Deimos. Where did he come from?
Yeah. Both the Raven and...
nice one, CCP. You can't actually see which way the nozzle is going because everything's red.
Yeah, the Raven and the Eagle are still sitting pretty. The Megathron has taken heavy armor. Fantastic. Bob, I salute you. But also, Chaos, you put up one hell of a fight. You are not easy cookies to kill. And they say, you never, ever give up.
Here he goes. The almighty Big is now on 5% of his hull. He's about to pop a couple more missiles, and that'll be...
I'm telling you now, 150% for effort on that one.
I think a round of applause.
A round of applause, definitely, for that Eagle performance was absolutely unbelievable.
Well done there.
The Eye of the Tiger doesn't even begin.
Right, I think you should play the victory tune.
Indeed. This one we are playing out specially for Bob.
Well done, guys.
It was nice to know that I managed to call it properly. And you finished just as the Eye of the Tiger fades out. So, from all of us at Eve Radio, from me, DJ X-Man.
And me, DJ Star Fury.
This one's for you, Bob.
Back. DJ Zod here with DJ X-Man for the final semi-final match and one of the most anticipated ones so far.
Definitely.
Bob versus IAC.
On the right-hand side of your overview, we have IAC with a Kaldari, Navy Raven, Absolution, a Rapier, a Heretic, and an Ishka.
And on the left-hand side of your screen, we have Band of Brothers, aka Bob, fielding a Kaldari, Navy Raven, Vulture, Scimitar, Flycatcher, and an Ishkar.
Looks like we're getting straight into it, which is what we like to see. I don't think we're going to see any punches pulled on this one. It's going to be an out-and-out butt-kicking fest, so it should make some good TV. Let's see who gets first.
That rapier should help IAC keep some range on these guys, but I'm really not sure what's going to be done here. I'm very uncertain about it, and I think a lot of others are as well.
Well, bearing in mind that the top two ships that Bob are actually fielding are actually missile boats, I don't really think it's going to make an awful lot of difference if they've got range or not. Range only matters if you've got blaster setups. Blaster setups, stop them in the tracks, they can't do chuff. Heretic for IAC seems to be being called primary. Bob obviously going for first kill. Heretic is basically taking it quite happily. Armor maintenance drones all over his butt. And the flycatcher for Bob also being called primary as well, and also a little bit on the Ishka. I don't think IAC actually know whether they want to go for the Ishka or the flycatcher first.
No, I don't think either team really knows who to go for first here.
And that's bad, really,
going,
for these two
going
teams.
For the, well, going for the little guys first. I mean, it seems to make the most sense right off the bat, but.
Yeah,
I think it may be just a matter of time, but feeding these guys cap and on armor and everything else is just, it's too easy.
Yeah.
But at the same time, when you look at some of the bigger boys, I mean, it's going to take a longer time to take them out. This could be one long match.
Yeah, I do hope not, though. I mean, I've actually come to expect Bob to be ballsy, you know, to literally go out there and go, yeah, I'm going to kill you.
Bob moving back here, trying to put some distance between themselves and IAC. IAC moving in just... Are they holding at the center now?
Do you like waffles?
Yeah, we like waffles.
Do you like pancakes?
Yeah, we like pancakes.
Do you like French toast?
Yeah, we like French toast.
Dip, 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 can't wait to get a mouthful.
Waffles!
Back yet another match here with Mabrithiel for match versus Destiny versus Edge of Sanity. Two teams that I don't know if they actually fought in the last tournament or not.
I don't think they did, actually, to be honest. In fact, I'm pretty sure they haven't, because otherwise I'd have noticed. They do have some interesting ships out, though, I must admit. We've got three assault frigates for Destiny. It's quite interesting because I don't think we've seen We've seen a lot of faction frigates, but not so many hacks. Assault frigates, sorry.
Yeah, that's very true. On the right-hand side of your screen, on the left-hand side of your screen is Destiny, fueling an Absolution Drake, two Ishkers, and a Hawk. And on the right-hand side of your screen with Edge of Sanity, fueling a Megathron, Rupture, Curse, ooh, and a Jaguar.
Actually, I think I was told otherwise about the Rupture. I think it is actually the hack variant. Well, I'll need to check.
Could it possibly be? I don't believe so, though. Nope, we have
Rupture class hack. Yeah, it is. It's the Munin.
It is a Munin. Our information was, in fact, incorrect.
Might have just been a typo, I think. I was watching. I thought it was torture, but
okay. This is.
My word, this could be really...
This is turning out to be a little more interesting than we thought it would. It turns out the Ishker going down faster than it was, but he must be out of everything here. He's really running on empty, and this Megathron just might get taken out by an Ishker. And the size difference in these ships is, at least a good two classes away from each other. But, this is not a good day for Edge of Sanity, being taken out by an Ishker. That is,
it's so slow, it's painful.
It's very painful. This is completely unexpected. It was looking that the Ishker was going to win this fight.
Wow.
I'm really at a loss for words here. This is totally not expected, but I know that we are actually coming up. We think we got about another 4 minutes left in the match. if this Ishker can take out this Megathron, I think a lot of people are going to be, I think that's it. Especially given the circumstances with the Absolution getting lost, it was kind of sitting in a deadlock here. The Megathron currently at about half structure, and as you see, there's some nice flames coming off the hull here now. And the Ishker slowly working itself back up on shields and armor, doing quite nicely.
That's just so impressive. I would hate to be that Megathron pilot right now. That looks really, really painful.
A few people in local expressing their disdain at what exactly is going on here. And I think this is a first. I don't think we saw anything like this in the last tournament.
I would have expected a Megathron to have had a few more cap boosters than that, or maybe he just didn't fit any.
Possibly not. We saw a heavy use of cap boosters in the last tournament, where it was, there was the team that smashed Alliance 5. I can never remember them, but there was that Lone Raven left that had no ammo, but he had a ton of cap boosters left on him. But nothing, and this is the this gets the underdog win of the day, clearly. I mean, coming back from nothing, losing your Absolution, and then taking out a Megathron. Taking
out a piddly little frigate.
A Megathron with an assault frigate. I'm sorry, Edge of Sanity, but I don't know. Is that worse than losing your...
I just saw armor go off. He's using a repa. There's a green glow around him.
There is. He's doing quite nicely. I can't really say much more than that. Other than that, Destiny. Where did he go?
Oh, the Ishkers disappeared.
The Ishkers disappeared. I don't know what exactly is going on here.
It went out of range, apparently.
So Maker 7. Okay. Maker 7 in the final Ishker turns out has left the arena, which means an automatic heal to zero. He almost had that Megathron. All he had to do was keep pounding him for another couple minutes, and the match would have been done. Wow. Not an interesting... Well, I can't say it's not an interesting match. Not an exciting match, but definitely an interesting one.
And, certainly, Mr.
Not bizarre. Not an outcome that we quite expected. I don't know. What do you think? Do you think that's staged? Do you think this is staged?
I don't think I've seen more bizarre things in EVE in my life, short of...
In a tournament where things are very cut and dry.
Gentlemen, I give you the future.
And welcome back. This is KI Eds. I'm sat here with Ifni in the commentator's box. And we have the second match of the second round of the fourth Alliance Championships. And we're looking at Band of Brothers versus Star Fraction. And we are go. Ifni, what do we have fielded for Bob and for Star Fraction?
Well, a standard Bob setup of Raven, Drake, Guardian, Rook, two hook bills, and then three Maulus. Compared to...
Ten. Mighty Thoraxes. And we've seen them travelling at 1,600?
They're doing like 1,600 across the grid.
Yep, they've got to travel 70k. We know that the teams were 70k away before the fight started. We are seeing only focus fire on only Thorax.
Check out the drones, man. That is a lot of drones to be launching.
I tell you what, probably this in the region, could say, be pain. 50. This could be pain.
Jasmine, look, Constantine there.
The drones are arriving.
Oof,
the drones right now, where are they going to aggro? We had Jasmine Constantine. They're obviously trying to take out what they think is the FC for the Thoraxes. Yeah. They'll be back. They'll have backup FCs. They know they're going to lose one at least.
Last Starfighter in the Rook for Bob is the main target for
And the Rook is primary target, and he has everything on him. Blasters, drones, the lot.
Now, the two teams started about 70 kilometres apart, which for Michael Warp driving Thoraxes is a reasonable distance to cover.
And we have only the second, and
that guardian is
not transferring armor.
Wait for it.
That guardian is not transferring armor.
Now, I would imagine. This could be game over.
We have the guardian not transferring. I can only imagine they fitted specifically to jam the guardian.
The Marion jammers.
Now they're going after the Raven. The Raven is already taking heavy shield damage.
Kersoni on the top left of your screen, and having the chunks of his shield removed.
And the Thoraxes are holding out. We're looking at two Thoraxes down, the third one just entering armor now.
This is an immense turnout from Star Fraction here, an absolute upset to the established route.
We are seeing armor and cap transfer from the Guardian. Now, if they can get a rejam on that Guardian, this could change that really... And we're seeing Thoraxes being multiple Thoraxes being attacked now.
Damage is being levelled across several Thoraxes with two of them in armour as Kersoni goes into his armour. My God, I can't get the words out of my mouth fast
this
enough.
This is proper.
Half armour for Kersoni, who is the primary damage dealer for the Band of Brothers.
If that goes down, all they have is Drake and a load of small
this
ships.
This is goddamn awesome. Sorry, Bob, but fucking bring it. This is Kersoni here.
He's in low armor. He is.
Come on!
He's in low armor. He's Kersoni, into structure.
Kersoni going
more
into hull.
Down for Star Fraction.
Oh my God!
And he's gone.
Kersoni is down.
He's down.
This is an upset.
Wow!
My God. Bob now have Drake, Guardian, two hookbills, and three Maulus.
Bob have no chance. What Bob have right now?
One, two,
Drake
three.
Is already at a low shield.
We have seven Thoraxes left for the Star Fraction team, with two of them sat in armor at the moment.
But repping
as
now.
That Drake goes deep melted. Into armor. My God.
Absolutely. Like, he might as well not have even been there.
This is it. Drake is gone.
Bob are out.
This is it. This is the end of the road
Star
for the Band
Fraction
of Brothers.
Star Fraction right now are running around the
tournament.
House, naked probably, shouting their heads off, T-shirts pulled over their heads.
Here we go.
Willy wacky.
Guardian goes into armor. Chunks being removed. Oh, God, man.
That is absolutely the...
What an absolutely awesome setup.
I actually oversaw a small conversation beforehand between a couple of people, and one of the other teams sent tactics to beat Bob to the Star Fraction. I don't know if these were them, but if they were them, that guy right now is feeling pretty happy with himself.
Now, I've got my own dibs in this. One of my old characters, Neurotica, is actually flying for the Star Fraction team, so I'm like, I skilled her.
I assume you sold her.
Oh, yeah, lots of
Isk. Lots of beautiful Isk.
Totally worth all the money that the owner paid for it.
Absolute beating.
This is...
TWD and his unbeatable setup
This is the biggest upset to the tournament to date. They have won three tournaments on the trot and have just been beaten by a team of 10 Tech 1 cruisers. How much more
I see in local. Whee! Good fight. Back to Lineage 2. Whee! Kersoni.
Yep. Kersoni is now quitting even going back to Lineage 2.
Because apparently he can't.
Wow. I don't know anything else. Anything else that can top this now. This is... Absolutely.
It was the way it was
epic.
Done as well, wasn't it? The way it was done. 10 Thoraxes. Real. We're coming to get you. We don't care what you're going to bring. We're coming to get you. See if you can stop us.
Micro warped 70 kilometers to cross that grid.
And then took him down.
Get in their face.
And took him down like he wasn't even there. That jamming that Guardian at the beginning really helped take the Rook down.
There we go. That is it. That is an immense showing from Star Fraction there as they decimate the Bob team.
And that is not an understatement.
That was goddamn.
My microphone is broken, which is why it's popping, not because I spit. And so I've got this lovely phallic symbol.
Yeah. God, let's. Oh, I can't say anymore. Let's pass it back to the guys in the studio.
Hear that?
And welcome back to the commentary booth. This is it. There's been 6 days of carnage. Over 200 pilots have fielded for 40 alliances in 8 groups. We've had 80 group matches, 8 knockout matches, and quarterfinals and semifinals today. And this is it, the final of the Spring 2008 Alliance Tournament. And we have Evoke versus Tri.
These setups are so amazing. We've gotten so excited we've taken off our pants. Just saying. We have on the left, we have Evo, Harbinger, Curse, and almost a full set of ruptures, 6 ruptures, 1 Vigil. On the right side, we have 3 Megathrons, a Kaldari Navy Hookbill, 2 Maws, and 4 Griffins. These are fantastic final setups. This should be entertaining.
This is just going to be awesome. We've seen how much carnage a big pack of ruptures causes.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, I just can't wait for this to start. We've got the 10-second countdown and local from GM Nova.
And Tri on the right with their setup newly acquired, played last match and won with it. Evoke with somewhat of a new way of setting it up.
Absolutely. It's kind of a bit of a take on what Unreloaded went out with, but mm-hmm. with a little bit of cap warfare mixed in and a Harbinger to boot for that extra DPS.
Mm-hmm. But regardless of how it is, this match should be entertaining and it should be punches left and right. Already a Tri Griffin on the right side, going down to about 60% shield.
And absolutely, just an immense swarm of ECM drones. Mixture of Vespa EC600s and Hornet EC300s from Evoke, just absolutely swarming towards the Triumvirate team.
Evoke, of course, trying to jam the Triumvirate team to prevent them from doing damage and possibly their own jamming. And that, I think the first Griffin is down on the Triumvirate team. And oh my god, there's going to lose
another one. Oh, this is such a mess. This is terrible. There's just frigates dropping left, right, and center. One Griffin, one Maulus down for the Tri team. Evoke yet to lose a ship, but another Griffin down just as we speak.
This is looking bleak for Tri's electronic warfare, at least. We have lost 3 frigates so far, and the Navy Hookbill at about 40% armor, and a Griffin at about 50% armor.
We can see now that the Navy Hookbill for the Tri team is on the brink of going down. We have a Maulus with no shield. We have another Griffin with half armor, very little shield.
But what we've been unable to see for a while now is that Evoke's Harbinger is to 20% armor. This Harbinger is going to go down, and so is a Rupture at about the middle of the screen, just entering structure now. Oh my god, what a ship exchange.
Yep, this is an absolute pure DPS fight. There is very little in the way of any logistics. The only thing that I would say is that Tri slightly have the upper hand with a big hit point buffer on the Megathrons. But we're seeing there that Tri's electronic warfare just absolutely decimated. There is nothing left but the DPS now. Tri. Again, 5 ruptures left for Evoke.
Tri simply being left with their punches. They simply have to take jabs at those ruptures and try to prevent Evoke from further damaging them. Simply having lost their entire rack of e-warfare. We're going to see another...
I'm going to call it. I think Evoke are going to take this.
I think Tri are going to take this.
Oh, well, we can fight for it, but it might get a little bit messy because we're not wearing pants.
That is absolutely true. And the Tri Megatron really just bleeding armor. That Megathron is going to go down. The question is if he can take a rupture with him. That would of course be an ideal situation, leaving Evoke with very few damage dealers.
I'm changing my mind again. I just don't know who the hell is going to win this.
This is a fantastic final. This is going to be decided by one or two ships.
Again, from Evoke, we can see that they still have really Vesper and Hornet EC.
Screw the chairs. I'm standing up. This is simply too exciting. Elendar is really, really going to
50% structure, but at the same time, it looks as if we're losing one of the ruptures from Evoke.
The rupture
as well.
There on 50% on the screen. It is going down.
This is absolutely unbelievable. This is so
fantastic.
Close.
Oh my god, that triumvirate Megathron just hanging on by the inch of the nails. That is such an exchange.
Oh, this is down to one Blastothrawn, one curse, and one rupture.
This is so exciting. The Megathron just losing a bit of its shields now, and the rupture at about 80% armor.
I think it looks like Tri might take this. This is probably the closest final I have ever seen in an Alliance tournament.
Do you think this Megathron has any way of repairing its armor, or do you think they're doing kind of a turtle setup between them?
I think it's probably going to be a turtle setup, and we're live on television with no pants.
This is amazing. The rupture now being relatively stable at about 50% armor. And the Megathron bleeding into armor. I think I might have to change my vote because
at some point, that Megathron is going to need to reload. This is a sustained engagement,
and that might be the exact reason why the rupture is stable at about 50% at the moment.
This is pretty much it. The last sliver of structure just about to vanish for Triumvirate's team. And that is it.
Congratulations, Evoke, winners of the 5th Alliance Tournament.
That is it. As you can hear in the studio behind us, everyone is going wild. And congratulations to Evoke, 2008, Alliance Tournament champions.
Definitely. This is Stoffer and India Pirate and Verone, and we are going back to Spiral Junkie.
All right, gather around, ladies. Everybody put your makeup bag down. I know last year we all brought our purse and handbags and high heels to the tournament. We kind of let Nelly win, but not this year. I have the winning strategy. Has anybody seen Elise?
I'm in a mower. What is this, hot drop, like, number 19? Ah! Really a titan for a mower? Dude hasn't been on a legitimate kill. All right, just small ballers, mate. Small ballers.
Okay, hello one more time to the nearly 10,000 of you still listening to the epic conclusion of EVE Alliance Tournament 6. I'm Kill2, I'm here with Krovin. Final match, most amazing matchup we could have hoped for, RUR versus Pandemic Legion. We're going to walk you guys through the setups to start off. I'm looking at one Abaddon and 9 Caracalt Navy issues for RUR, changing their setup finally after an entire tournament of doing an awesome job with the turret setup.
And then over on the Pandemic Legion side, we have the same setup from the semifinal. The Claymore, the Sleipnir, the 7 Vexor Navy issues, and Hyena. And we're still a couple minutes out, so we're also, for those of you, you might see them. Yeah, military experts are calling these Titans. But you were saying RUR is really drastically changing the setup here. 9 Caracals and an Abaddon.
You know, I said before the match, they've got to change something, or PL will just break them, because it's too easy to counter something if you bring it over and over and over and over. Even though they had a really, really strong setup for most of the tournament, they've changed it. Unfortunately, in my opinion, they're going to have a really tough decision. They can take out the sentry drones from the PL Navy Vexers and limit the damage. If they do that, they're going to have Vexers all over them, hitting them with blasters. Or they can shoot the Vexers, and they'll have a lot of damage to deal with. It's going to be really interesting to see how this goes.
Yeah, definitely. And it looks like we see the go in local, and off go those Vexers. No sentries.
Not yet. They're flying.
No, they're moving either. I mean, they'd have dropped them by now.
Yeah, they didn't drop them. Last time, remember, they flew away from the fight, dropped the sentries, and then head back, like Ed said. They are taking a fair amount of damage, of course. The Navy Caracal's running heavy missiles. Those are pounding on War God and Navy Issue Vexor right now. He's at about half armor.
Yeah, so, I mean, well, you could also, I mean, we could see three heavies, two mediums, and one light drone pop out of each of these Vexors as well. And War God is just about to hit into structure. And again, even though they brought the same setup, Pandemic Legion definitely not coming with the same game plan.
No, I still don't see any major Pandemic Legion drone presence. I see some guard twos now at one end of the field. I think there's sentry drones out. I think they've got sentry drones dropped all over the field, but they went out pretty late. Okay, now we lost a Caracal. About to lose a second Caracal. DPS now on the field for PL.
Yeah, it's just they didn't drop them at the word go. And so we have a second Vexor now taking some armor damage, just about to hit structure. A third Vexor with no shields left. That Abaddon shooting some Scorch ammo across the field, and we just lost one of those Vexors. So this is already a very tight match.
Of course, the damage getting much lower every time one of these Vexors go down, but PL had those two command ships, which are a huge obstacle for the RUR team to overcome, even if they get all the Vexors out of the way. Third Caracal now entering structure. He'll be going down shortly. I notice EWAR on most of the ships, at least on the Caracals. I think the Vexors are running some sort of electronic support. I saw them targeting each other, I think. Maybe a sensor booster, like remote sensor or something like that. I have no idea.
Yeah, and that Caracal has gone down. Now we have another Vexor just about to hit structure. This is way too close to call. And down he goes. Down goes that Vexor. So we're, these two teams, two of the most fantastic performances in Alliance tournament history, exchanging blows very evenly here. We're seeing another Caracal about to enter armor, another Vexor in armor.
Yeah, and obviously that decision we talked about earlier, the Caracal's choosing to shoot the Vexors, not the sentry drones, probably a good choice, especially since the sentry drone drop was delayed. That could be why they delayed it. Now Mr. Rive's Vexor at about 20% armor. He'll be going down pretty soon. DPS slowing down as both teams lose ships. Right now, only four Vexors left, two command ships for Pandemic Legion, and we still have six Caracal Navy Issues and an Abaddon. That Abaddon, a huge powerhouse in this match, still on the field.
Well, and now we're seeing split damage across three of the Navy Caracals for RUR. This is where this electronic warfare from these Caracals could be coming into play, forcing Pandemic Legion to split their fire, and basically whatever they can lock. Of course, two of them now entering armor, and the armor on these Caracals is going to be paper thin.
Yeah, so is the shields. I'm looking at them. I don't see invulnerability fields. I don't see shield boosters. I think they went with a full dampener setup, which at this point is starting to split the DPS up, which is helping them a lot. But they're really thin, so once that DPS does get focused at all, they go down. We just lost two more Vexors.
They're
only two left now, and lost a Caracal, about to lose another Caracal. This match couldn't be more representative of this tournament. Ships dying constantly.
This is absolutely fantastic. That Caracal did just finally go down, so we're left with an Abaddon and four Navy Caracals against a Claymore Sletner, two Vexor Navy Issues, and the Hyena. This is just... And now we're seeing another one of those Vexors now in armor, the Hyena taking some damage, the Abaddon now taking shield damage as well, and now a Caracal still down at about 25% shields. I'm not sure if he's managing. I didn't take a look at what kind of drones those were either, what kind of sentries, because the sentry drones...
Oh, I saw guard twos.
They're guards. Okay, so not the longest range drones, but very effective against
high
the
damage.
Shield tank. Yeah.
This is exactly what RUR would have wanted. The Abaddon starting to take some of the sentry aggro. Abaddon can handle it for a long time, and the Caracal stay up, so that's really what they would have wanted. We're about to lose one more Navy Vexor, leaving only one left, and then after that, it's just some Slipner and Claymore, which turret-dependent DPS. If the Caracals are faster, they can avoid that for a long time. Only four Caracals left now for RUR, though.
Yeah, and one of them is now at half armor, so some of that damage being focused back around. We're down to one more Vexor left for Pandemic Legion. It's going to be a slugfest to the end. I mean, remember, if any of these Caracals do survive, that, as I said earlier, Minotaur command ships do tend to have a bit of a weakness toward kinetic damage. Oh, that the Caracal's still hanging on, half structure now, just about. We see a massive trail of fire coming off the back of him, but that Vexor still consistently taking damage. Two more Caracals out of shields now.
You know, in Pandemic Legion's last match against Evoke, we saw the Blasters play a huge role, adding tons of DPS to the PL team. They have the Blasters again. This time, the RUR team fielding a faster set of ships, the Vexors having a lot more trouble catching up and doing their damage. Just lost two more Caracals. Only two Caracals left for RUR. Still a Vexor and two command ships left on the field for Pandemic Legion.
This is an absolute nail biter. I think, I mean, my rough guesstimate on points is that they're actually not terribly far off. Pandemic Legion may have the edge, but I don't think it's going to matter. This one's going to go down to who's the last man standing on the field. We could see Hero tanking action off that Abaddon. We're seeing another Caracal now, almost through shields. That Vexer, still almost all the way through its armor.
I'm looking at this Vexer right now. He's actually out of range of the heavy missiles from the Caracals. They are not getting there. The Abaddon's shooting Scorch, but it doesn't look like it's doing any damage either. This RUR team has got to catch up to that last Vexer and put some damage on it to finish it off. It's at 40% armor, and they really need it to die.
Yeah, no, because its sentries are still out there, right? And, I mean, every bit of damage that you can take away from this team is going to be helpful. I mean, a Sletner is a very high damage ship, potentially. A Claymore can do pretty respectable damage also. But, you know, the sentries were really the linchpin here. And now we're seeing that, you know, that RUR Caracal that we saw taking a lot of damage earlier, it's also not taking much damage right now. So it may have outranged those guards that are back there on the field. And now that Vexer did just take a little bit more damage. I don't know what's caught him, if it's drones or... I'm peeking in really close, but I still can't quite make it out.
He is taking missile damage now. I think this Claymore for the Pandemic Legion team, running some kind of EWAR on the Abaddon from RUR, possibly a tracking disruptor. I could be wrong, could be a sensor dampener, but the Abaddon was able to shoot. So if it's a sensor dampener, not doing enough. And now the Slipner for the Pandemic Legion team starting to take some damage, but an RUR Caracal about to die, about 10% structure and down. So one Abaddon. One Caracal Navy issue versus a Vexer Navy issue in structure, and two Minmatar command ships left for the Pandemic Legion team.
Yeah, and I mean, like we were saying, you know, one of the disadvantages to switching up your setup is that while you may have practiced it 1,000 times, you don't have that experience in the tournament against an opponent, and that Vexer's down. So we're now down to the Abaddon, a Caracal Navy issue versus a Slepner, which is quickly taking shield damage, and a Claymore. The Caracal is at half shields. The Abaddon has no shields, but obviously that's not much of a problem for it. Those are bonus hit points, effectively.
This may come down to a lot of piloting decisions, too. Of course, an Abaddon, limited, you know, not too mobile. I don't know if he has a web fitted. My guess is no. And Slipner and Claymore, both fairly quick. These ships should both have micro-warp drives. They both have decent range with autocannons. They can manipulate that Abaddon, especially if the Claymore has tracking disruptors. And they may be able to finish the Abaddon by themselves. We're seeing that last Caracal now. For the RUR team, has a Claymore right on top of it. He's in armor. He'll be going down soon.
Yeah, but no web, it looks like, on him, because he's running away with great alacrity at the minute. So he's just about to peek into structure, and he's stopped. He's turning around now, and that could be the end of him.
Yeah, I think he's going to be going down in just a second. We see this Abaddon. I got to figure out how fast he's going.
Yeah. He's
going 651 meters a second, so he has a microwarp. It might be decided based on whether or not he has a web. We've also seen Cat be a huge issue for these ships in recent matches. We're about to lose that Caracal, a really big loss for the RER team. You are the Cinderella story of Alliance Tournament 6 versus two Minmatar command ships, a Claymore and a Slipner for Pandemic Legion.
Wow, and yeah, we did lose that Caracal. It's going to be a bit of a chore for this Slipner and this Claymore to get through that Abaddon, and they're going to have to get reasonably close, which means chancing the range on those pulse lasers, but we're not seeing them fire right now. That Abaddon, I will almost guarantee you, he is capped out right now after running that micro warp drive. They have everything but your mental enjoy.
I mean, my heart's beating, my hands are shaking, but I'm still shooting, I'm still getting the headshots, it's like, boom, headshot, boom, headshot, I'm still getting the shots, it's like, boom, headshot, boom, headshot, boom, headshot, I mean, my heart's beating, my hands are shaking, but I'm still shooting, I'm still getting the headshots, it's like, boom, headshot, boom, headshot, I'm still getting the shots, it's like, boom, headshot.
All right, hello everyone, this is Kill 2. I'm here with Ryan in the commentary box bringing you the first semifinal of Alliance Tournament 7. We have Pandemic Legion on your left versus Manifest Destiny. Pandemic Legion have brought one Loki, two Slipners, one Claymore, one Hurricane, one Scimitar, two Sabers, a Thrasher, and a Tyrannus.
And Manifest Destiny has brought two Tengus, a Basilisk, two Rooks, two Lachesis, and two Cormorants. This is going to be awesome. This is Team Mimitar versus Team Whatever. You know, we're going to see missiles, we're going to see explosions, we're going to see autocannons, and we're going to see a whole heck of a lot of damage on this one. I'm really, really, really excited about this. And I wasn't originally for Pandemic Legion on this one, but all that Mimitar, it does it for me.
Okay, what happened here? Pandemic Legion team warped to zero on the beacon. Manifest Destiny, it looks to me like, have brought a counter to the Pandemic Legion setup they've been running for the last few matches. They brought Lachesis, probably for damps for the stealth bombers. They brought a lot of ECM and they brought missiles. Pandemic Legion saw it coming. They went for a setup that would counter that exactly. I think Pandemic Legion's going to run over them in this match.
Oh my god, there is not a single ship on the Pandemic Legion side that is not doing at least 3,000 to 2,000 meters a second. These guys are speed fit. They are going in to hit hard, hit fast, and just deal damage. They have been speeding directly into the pack of the Manifest Destiny team, and there's no distance separating these teams anymore. There's just nothing but drones and craziness going on.
That is seriously incredible. That team is going so fast. The command ship's putting out so much damage. They're already right on top of the Manifest Destiny team. Manifest Destiny already lost a Rook.
Yeah, Rook? What Rook?
Presumably the second Rook will be going down pretty soon. There is a lot of jamming, at least there was. There won't be soon, so it may take a second, but I assume the DPS will pile on pretty soon here.
Now, I am just totally impressed by this team. They have clearly tried to do, again, coming completely out of the box, changing their setup at the last possible second, but they're going to have to hold just a little bit longer. They need to get that Rook down, they need to get it go down fast, and then they immediately need to go after that Basilisk pilot before losing their Scimitar as the Rook explodes.
Now, the Scimitar goes, 3,000 meters a second, so he can get to the other side of the arena in no time. There's missiles, obviously, Tengus, it won't make a huge difference, but, I mean, there's just no way that Manifest Destiny can finish this match, even if they get the Scimitar down. It's just way too much from the Pandemic Legion side. They're already finished that second Rook, they're working on a Cormorant now, and they're working on the Basilisk, mainly, just like Ryze anticipated.
Yeah, and, you know, with this much speed, this much damage going on, it's going to be very tough for them to be able to tank that. Wow. Yeah, was there hull involved in that ship? All I saw was a sliver of shields and then an explosion. Cormorant down as well. Those Lachesis, you know, banking on using their range scripts to be able to actually track and disrupt, that's not going to do anything against a close-range, high-speed Mimitar setup like this.
Pandemic Legion saw the ECM coming. They brought, electronic countermeasures. God, the Manifest Destiny team just freaking disappearing. Both Lachesis gone already.
You know, this is why Mimitar absolutely rule and dominate when it comes to the small ships like this. So much damage, so much speed, so much punch. Those Tengus are going to completely melt underneath those Slipners. I'm sure that those Slipners are fitting three, maybe four damage mods in their lows. Stacking penalties be damned.
This is freaking incredible. Tengu's going down next. The Pandemic Legion team, of course, already all on top of him. We see Tengu's run around the arena with Battlecruiser struggling to catch up. Pandemic Legion not having those kind of problems. Already this Tengu at half shields.
Yeah, that Tengu is just not going to survive long. Slipner, very well known for being extremely high DPS. Obviously a max skill Claymore pilot, probably running a Ganglink and Mind Link together, running all three speed, signature radius, and probably the propulsion mods as well, using their webs at the maximum range. I wouldn't be surprised if they're...
A Cormorant gone, Tengu gone. It's like we shouldn't even talk about anything except how fast these ships are dying. It's freaking unbelievable.
Can you guys just watch the screen and pick your tongues, your jaws up off the floor, you know, try and keep it together, because I sure as hell can't. This Tengu has no hope at all of surviving. There goes a billion isk pop, and, you know, just it's going to be a couple of seconds. And look at those beautiful, beautiful Thrasher holes just warping right into there.
Pandemic Legion using a Loki with the web bonus, something it can do like the Hugin, so they've got speed along with some tackle. In case there was anything else that went 3,000 meters a second, they wouldn't have had a problem slowing it down.
I mean, we've been looking for that counter all week long to the, you know, Kaldari-ranged ECM. Ladies and gentlemen, Pandemic Legion found not one, but two different counters. One in the stealth bombers, and the second one in the speed Mimitar gang. And there could... Bam! What? Tengu gone. 1 billion down. That guy's going to be hurting for skill points. Are you guys even ready for us back in the studio? We'll be right back.
too much. That's just that Hawk. He's getting boosted up by the Etana, no problem.
All right, so Mollus from the Tuskers team taking a little bit of damage right now. It's got full reps. It's got rep drones on it. So Afterlife, they're just happy to wait for a little while. They've got their entire frigate wing and T3 destroyer wing out
front.
What's
that Tuskers Mollus doing? You see where he's at? He's flown like almost to where he's on top of.
He's a little bit out of range. He doesn't want. Oh, okay. Here we go. The Afterlife team is now charging with their support wing. I think that was a Mollus bait right there.
Yeah, it looks like it. I mean, if they keep him up, it definitely was a pretty sweet job by him. He's on.
Cool, what are you doing?
Cool, where are you going?
Cool, what are you doing?
Cool, what the fuck are you doing?
Cool, come back. DC'd.
No, I don't know.
Just come back.
Cool, come back.
We're gonna go for Zed. We're gonna go for the ZIR. Cool, what the fuck are you doing? Go for the Raptor. Fuck's sake, cool.
OTT. Okay.
OTT Raptor. Go for OTT Raptor. Call Effigently Jams on the Etana, please.
Raptor's pulling range. Alright, finals time. The end of Alliance Tournament 8. We have Hydro Reloaded versus Pandemic Legion. The match we've all been waiting for. I'm Kill2. I'm here with Angel Hun on the left for Hydro Reloaded. We have their same setup. Three Myrmidons. Three Rooks, and a Neros, an Ishker, and two Tyrannus.
And for Pandemic Legion's reigning champions, perhaps going for a three-peat, we have a Claymore, three Sleipnir, one Hugin, one Scimitar, three Sabers, and a Thresher. A full Matari setup against a mixed setup from Hydro Reloaded.
And here we go. Teams warping from adjacent beacons. PL putting a lot of their heavy stuff down near the center of the beacon, the rest of their support a little further out. And already Hydra Tyrannus down. First blood to PL really quick out of the gate.
That was incredibly fast. We're seeing a ton of damage drones, mostly Valkyrie 2s coming from Pandemic Legion, with some Warrior 2s coming out of Hydra Reloaded. It doesn't look like jams are on all of the Pandemic Legion team. An incredible amount of damage spread throughout those three Sleipnir. Range control with that Hugin. Excellent support ships with choices with those sabers. I think this could be a very quick one-sided match.
One Myrmidon taking damage quickly, second one going into armor right after. At the same time, another Hydra Tyrannus down. It looks like Hydra was putting some damage onto a saber. I see a Myrmidon sitting on top of a Sleipnir. Damage all spread out. Obviously, mobility an issue when you have so much tackle on the PL side and so much speed. No real significant damage. One PL Sleipnir taking some pretty serious shield damage, but at the same time, the first Myrmidon for Hydra about to fall.
And we're seeing more smart bombs as employed by Panda Team early in the tournament by one of the Sleipnirs. I believe that might be Ravy, one of the closer Sleipnirs here. Fantastic initial showing by Pandemic Legion, proving why they have always achieved this position in the tournament. A very, very impressive initial, 3 minutes, and we have almost 50% of the Hydra Reloaded team dead and in pods.
Ishker taking damage. Second Myrmidon already at half armor. Not enough jams to keep the PL DPS at bay, and not enough mobility to get focused and bring down some of their ships. These setups, it's so interesting to know. I mean, ECCM's running on every PL Sleipnir. Second Myrmidon down now. Ishker following shortly after. Only one ship left on the field for Hydra capable of doing any damage. PL has this in the bag.
PL definitely has this in the bag. I think we're going to go with a three-peat here. Fantastic showing, Pandemic Legion. An incredible, incredible performance by you guys. Props. So, Kill2, what about that Costco girl?
I'm not going to talk about that. Myrmidon going down. The third one. After that, they'll just have to clean up these rooks. PL probably anticipating the setup here. They know, I think that it was kind of clear that Hydra had committed to this setup. They felt really good about it. It had won several matches in a row. But just not enough when PL knows what they're going to have to deal with. I wish Hydra would have switched it up coming into this match.
And welcome to the second match of the day. This is Shadu and Zastro commenting in what might as well be the final match of the day. We have an upset today here, I believe. We have Pandemic Legion versus Darkseid.
Yes.
What do we have?
This could be one of the closest and most exciting matches of the day. Darkseid was my personal favorite to maybe take the entire tournament as a dark horse. These are teams we did not expect to... These are setups we did not expect them to bring. PL's got three Tengus, a Basilisk, two Healas, and three Worms, while Darkseid has three Legions, a Guardian, two Curses, two Crew Roars, and two Maledictions.
And the match is underway, and what we look like to have here is Darkseid versus... Darkseid is running a Amar Rush team, while a Pandemic Legion is running a Tengu Kite team. However, both teams are rushing right towards each other.
Yes.
These Pandemic Legion Tengus are going right on top of the Darkseid Legions. What is going on?
I have no idea. I don't know. Already, Darkseid Curse is taking heavy damage. It's in
heavy
armor.
Beating.
PL is not looking like they're taking much damage yet.
Pandemic Legion Tengu is taking heavy fire from these legions, which of course are all firing EM damage to a shield setup, but for some reason Joe Fishy is tanking them! What is going on?
The curse, Flaffy Waffy on the Darkseid team, also tanking all the damage Pandemic's doing.
Neither side is making a dent on each other while both of them are right on top of each other. This is a Tengu setup we have not seen before. Are they running assault missiles?
I have no idea what they're... I mean, the missiles all look kind of the same to me, but those Tengus certainly went right in.
For some reason, Pandemic Legion is focusing on the Legion from the Darkseid side instead of their Guardian. And now the Ken in the Basilisk has gone in and gotten tackled and is taking heavy fire. If that Basilisk dies, the match is over and Pandemic Legion is out of this match. And my bet would have come true. And Ken is gone. He is taking serious fire and his instruction,
he's gone.
He's gone. That's it.
PL will be going down. We've seen for the entire tournament, shield tanking teams have done much better than the armor tanking teams, but this armor tanking Darkseid setup is holding off all the damage that Pandemic is doing to it so far. Pandemic unable to keep their Basilisk alive against the Darkseid damage. Darkseid has one curse. It's taking armor damage now, but he is tanking it, and he's getting wrapped back up. PL's not going to be able to break that curse's tank, I don't
think. Absolutely not. Pandemic Legion should have gone for that Guardian. I don't know why they didn't, and that cost them the match and this tournament. Pandemic Legion is going to be out of this tournament.
PL's losing ships. Two worms down. That's three two worms down. They have nothing left. Two Tengus, two Healers, and then one worm is all they have left. Darkseid having taken no casualties yet. They have one curse and low armor, but everything else is still alive. At this point in time, it's just going to cascade against Pandemic Legion. Darkseid in the superior
absolutely position here. First upset of the tournament. Darkseid played this well. They went for the logistic ship. They damped him down, forced him in, and he got tackled, neutered, and scrambled, and he was gone. He was dead. And while this curse is slowly dying, it does not matter because now Joe Fishy is taking heavy fire, and he is going to die shortly after this curse dies. And that's the match gone. Pandemic
wow.
is out.
Shadu, is this what you expected? Is this a setup that you expected PL to bring?
It's not what I would have expected them to bring. Of course, this seemed on an outset like a good setup to bring. They were tanking it well, while Darkseid thought that they were running as kiting Tengus. However, this rush team, what it looks to be have been, really didn't perform well when they actually Darkseid called the right target and took out that logistic ship. And as the Tengu goes down, that is a majority of damage. Now, 1/5 of damage down from the Pandemic Legion side. They have lost their logistic ships. They have lost their dampening ships. Darkseid has this in the back.
It's all going against PL at this point in time. They really have no chance to come back from it. Being in PL, Shadu, you knew what their other setups were. What did you expect them to bring?
I expect them to bring something better. I don't know what kind of intel they had on Darkseid, but it didn't work out. Darkseid brought a Amar Rush team against a Shield Rush team, and with that high EM thermal damage and the hole on the shield of the ships on the Pandemic Legion side.
The resist hole.
Resist hole, that was match done. Darkseid had this back from the start, and it's just a cleanup crew right now. And funnily enough,
PL did try to bring their own Amar Rush team yesterday, didn't they?
Exactly.
And how did that work out for PL?
And gone. And Darkseid brought pretty much the same team that PL ran exactly yesterday. and were beaten by a Matari Rush team. But Goldari against Amar with that
totally different setup.
Holes.
Totally different setup. Do you think Darkseid may have had intel on what PL was planning on bringing?
Perhaps they might have had a suspicion on it. It is a little bit risky from Darkseid to bring a Amar Rush team, which does lose to an ECM team as well as a Min Matar Rush team. So I don't know. Perhaps they had a little bit of insider intel here. Whatever it was, it worked out very well for them. This may have, as I said before, Darkseid was one of the teams that we absolutely did not want to face, because we knew that they had this in their back.
Absolutely.
We knew that they were able to beat us, and they just did.
What I really appreciate about Darkseid, too, is the fact that it is an Amar team, and there's been a lot of talking on the forums and in the commentary studio this whole week about we haven't really seen many Amar ship setups or Galente ship setups, and when people have tried them, they haven't really gone too well. I think it was very ballsy of Darkseid to sack up and bring an Amar team against PL, the defending champions for how many tournaments now? So
three. Exactly. Three. And just like Pretty Justice, Seamus Orsos have been left as the last ship standing. They have stopped firing on me. They're holding by the nuts there, dangling them. Look, we did this to you. You are gone.
Darkseid is now reveling in their victory. They're chatting in local. They're smacking a little bit, but
they're
it's all
saying,
good nature.
This is how you fly Legion.
Absolutely.
That is awesome.
It has got to feel so good for Darkseid to bring a similar theme setup that PL brought yesterday and win with it against PL themselves.
Not just similar, but I believe exactly the same.
Exactly the same.
And with that, Seamus Orsos is taken out after being dangled up in there. Victory goes to Darkseid. Dave, go forward. Pandemic Legion is out.
What
and with that,
an upset.
We're back to the studio.
What
I hope all you viewers at home got a very good look at Michael Bolton's mustache during that last segment, because it is not going to be with us very much longer. Hun Reloaded has brought back the Vargers, PL has brought back the Widows, and we have a fight ahead of us that, I see. Hun can still surprise us. This is Ravy here with Kill 2. We're about to see the first of our semifinals. It's Pandemic Legion versus Hun Reloaded. Hun has only switched up one ship in their setup from the last match, switching to Loki from their one Sleipnir. And PL has brought the same Torp Widow setup as before.
And
what do
one, showing Michael Bolton, one slightly relevant piece of information is that the Loki that's come in instead of the Sleipnir for Hun does have the added sensor strength subsystem. Mm-hmm. Not a huge deal, but there is some ECM resilience on this team,
even though
the Vargers are obviously.
The Vargers are going to have ECCM,
right.
But I'm not sure it's going to be enough. The match is about to start. We had been talking before about whether Hun Reloaded or Giant Strategic Geniuses playing chicken with the rest of the tournament, or if they had just no other setups to bring, and I think we've seen the answer.
I mean, the tough thing about that is you never know if they just lost the game of chicken. If they just brought this thinking PL wouldn't expect them to and made a bad judgment there, they might still be Strategic Geniuses. But we are underway now.
We're going to be seeing damage being applied. There is some damage coming onto one of the flycatchers, Doefish's flycatcher for PL. It's being repped. We have jam attempts on virtually every ship for Hun Reloaded. We'll see how much those are working. But we're not seeing a lot of damage coming across.
I'm checking the Vargers. One Varger shooting, one Varger not shooting. Right now, Hun Reloaded headed away from the PL team, trying to kite. give themselves time to maybe get some support down. And there goes Griffin number one.
First blood goes to Hun Reloaded, taking down Elise Randolph, CSM's Griffin. And now they're working on a Hawk, testing out tanks, looking for what the weakest thing is. Those Vargers do have great range with Barrage, so picking off those frigates at range is something they're very good at once they can get locks. And it just requires really one of them to be able to break through. Got another Griffin of Hatsumi also going down. So the ECM ships for PL are dropping. This is not a good sign for PL. If they lose this last Griffin, that's going to be a decent chunk of their jamming off the field. But now the Vargers for Hun Reloaded are getting near the edge of the arena. So they're not going to keep running like this forever.
Yep, they just made a hard turn to the right. So we'll probably end up with some tackles sometime soon here. But still, for now, looking really good. They're maybe going to get that last Griffin down, and that's a lot of jammers. I mean, that definitely opens up at least their support and possibly their logistics to have locks for a good portion of the fight, which
Electro Descendants Griffin is getting shot at, but he is being repped up. He's not bleeding into armor yet. If he starts bleeding into armor, that's when we know we're going to have a big problem for him. But at the moment, he's doing fine. He is, however, the guy that flew out of the arena last match, and he actually had looted Darkseid's flagship before that. It flew out of the arena with a 5 billionist weapon assault.
Yeah,
so hopefully he can avoid doing that this time. He is losing armor, though, so he's going to go down before too long if this keeps up.
And the first Varger is webbed, so soon we should start to see damage from those Widows getting applied to Yago Yun there in the Varger. Newt's landing now. That Griffin still tanking also. Obviously really low armor, but hanging in there for right now.
Yeah, if they can take down these Vargers, it's going to get a lot easier for PL. They need to knock down the long-range DPS fast, and then they can start working on either Scimitar or the Hawks. There's Electo dropping into armor once again, losing Bestructure, and there he goes.
Griffin down.
So there goes. All three of the Griffins have disappeared for PL. We still don't have a single loss for Hun Reloaded.
And it's funny, before the match, Ravy, you said that they put Sheamus in the Ferox because they would never shoot at it, but right now that looks like it's the primary for the Hun Reloaded team.
There looks like a split. It's far between that and Tinking Basilisk. We'll see which one ends up getting the full brunt of it. It looks like they're switching over to... they still have some damage on Sheamus. I don't think they're going to have too much trouble tanking a Ferox, though, as long as most of that team stays jammed. The Varger of Yago Yun for Hun Reloaded is tanking just fine with his ASB, but the question is going to be whether or not he can survive through his first reload.
Yeah, and you can see there pretty much the entire PL team is piled on top of him now. Torp's probably doing absolute max damage on him. He's probably not going anywhere, but he is tanking really comfortably right now. Like you say, it'll be interesting to see what happens when he runs out of charges. And damage split all over the place across the PL team. With those Griffins down, it looks like they're not sure exactly where the weakest link is, maybe?
Yeah, they're putting most of the fire now on Teen King. Probably a good choice. He's ASB tank, but once he runs out, then they'll be able to do some significant damage to him. But if PL can take down one of these Vargers before he runs out, then they'll be in good shape. However, now Dalman's Widow dropping fast. He's repping, but he's going down pretty quickly. Oh, he looks like he's going to slip into armor any second now. He probably won't have a whole lot of armor.
Wow.
So it'll be fascinating to see what happens once that drops. And the Varger of Yago Yun is still holding up.
An interesting decision there. You see smart bombs going on in the middle of the match there coming from the Vargers. They had sets of augmented drones from PL on them, both ogres and hammerheads. But at the same time, they did have shield maintenance bots as well. And they're smart bombing all that stuff off. This Widow is probably going to go down.
Wow, if Hun Reloaded can take out PL using a Varger team against ECM, then it's possible that this Varger team just can't be beat in that case, because this is about as close to a hard counter as we're going to see.
Keep in mind, though, that all this is dependent on locks. These ships can get jammed at any moment, and damage can slow down by a ton, which might be happening now as we see the Widow pulling back to about half shields. At the same time, Hun Reloaded Scimitar now webbed in about half shields himself. That's pretty important.
Yeah, we're only seeing now jam attempts on three ships. With the Griffins down, PL has all of their jammers focused on the Vargers and the Scimitar, which means the Hawks, the Loki, the Merlins, all are able to fire. That can't be good. They need to be able to knock out some ships so they can move these jams elsewhere.
I'm checking Yago Yun right now. It looks like he is jammed. He doesn't have any turrets active. I'm going to run over and check Justice really quick to see if he has turrets active, which it looks like he does not. So both Vargers probably unable to shoot right now, which is why you saw that Widow completely
recover. Dalman's Widow surviving the moment in structure while they go after the Hun Reloaded Scimitar. But that Hun Scimitar is pulling back. He's got a Ferox on him. He's being neutered and shot. He's going to lose his hardener soon, and that's going to really hurt.
Tons of cap warfare effects going on in here. There's newts and cap transfer going on for both teams. What was that?
So we're seeing that Scimitar dropping. It looks like he's probably on reload. There he gets another boost. But the Basilisk for Tink Gang dropping into armor.
Oh my gosh.
Oh, giant chunks. It looks like one of the Vargers got locks
down.
On. And he's down. Tink Gang is down. PL no longer has their Basilisk. While the Scimitar for Hun Reloaded is a moment still boosting. through the damage. He's going to go down too, but this is going to be very, very difficult for PL at this point. Having lost three of their ECM ships.
Oh, the Widow hurting bad again now. Look,
that
the Widow's
going to die. Dalvin's Widow is going to go down any second now.
Boom.
And there he goes. Now, the question is Yagle Yoon going to be on his reload? Did he try to take that? Nope.
He's still boosting right now.
So the question will be whether he reloaded in the period of time in between.
There's another boost.
Because if he's low, then he may go down fast. That's probably what they must be hoping for. They must be hoping that he hasn't reloaded.
I think he got off a reload because he's boosting steadily right now, getting back up towards full HP, which means he's probably got another 5, 6, 8 boosts maybe.
Yep.
And the second Widow for PL going into armor right now.
It looks like we are about to see PL knocked out of the tournament by Hub Reloaded, bringing the same setup through almost the entire tournament.
Wow.
This is an amazing sight to see. Hun Reloaded with obviously incredibly confident in their Vargers. They must have tested this against ECM and decided that it was just good enough. And if they bring this, I assume they're going to bring this for the final.
They would have to.
If you were Exodus and Verge, what must you be thinking right now?
Like, I'm out of here.
Yeah.
I'll bring Vargers.
Yeah, like,
I would bring the same setup,
but
I
you
guess.
Know that you're not going to be as experienced as Hun Reloaded and using Vargers. You need to. If everyone had been assuming that a good ECM team was going to be the counter to the Vargers, these Vargers just got enough locks. They
Widow
had overloaded
down.
ECM. That's PL is getting knocked out of the tournament by a setup that everyone thought they were hard countering.
You know, Verge is really comfortable with Chrono setups. Mm-hmm. I think I might just do that.
That would be a decent option.
Bring Chronos.
Marauder versus Marauder, get the higher damage blasters. Yep.
Tears have been shed. Blood has been spilled. Billions of ISK lost. And thousands of man-hours have earned nothing but failure. Space is now littered with the wrecks and corpses of those who have failed in their task. But for these two teams, these most elite of the elite, none of that matters anymore. They have laid waste to all who have opposed them. But only one of them can win this coveted title. Who will become the champions of New Eden? This is the 11th Alliance Tournament Final.
Here we are once again. Hello, everyone. This is CCB Fozzie here with Shadu. We're bringing you the final match of this best 3 out of 5 series, Hydra Reloaded, Pandemic Legion, the winner of this for all the marbles for the 11th Alliance Tournament Championship.
And have we got a match for you? Pandemic Legion is choosing to bring the Hail Mary they fielded earlier in the previous match, while Hydra Reloaded has chosen to bring a setup that Exodus fielded. So they copied a setup from Exodus Alliance that they beat Pandemic Legion earlier today with.
But that also lost to Pandemic's Tinker Team. That being said, this is not exactly the same setup. The difference is the Claymore instead of the Sleipnir. Sleipnir was banned by PL. Instead, Hydra is a Claymore.
How did they know that?
That's a lot
How
less damage.
How did they know
I'd be very curious to find out.
Oh my god. The match is underway here. What we will
very
see
gutsily,
is...
Very gutsily, PL is warped in at 0. That's not what they did last time.
Wow.
This is a huge, huge choice. And they're going straight for the Logi, I'm sure. The Scimitar,
both teams are going for the Scimitar trait. The Pandemic Legion Scimitar is now whipped. Tingling is whipped. While Count Monte Carlo is whipped, scrambled, and neutered, and painted.
Both are using ASBs to repair themselves. We're going to see which one goes in first. It's all going to be about who can get the damage applied faster. These Rattlesnakes are already on top and neutering the Scimitar. They are brawling Rattlesnakes right up with this Claymore Gila team. And the Scimitar of Count Monte Carlo is going down faster. It is in low shield. It looks like the reps just aren't enough. It's going to go down first, but Tinking is going to go down. I'm sure Tinking will also die.
Tinking will absolutely go down.
But that is a first blood for PL. Scimitar down for
chunks of Tinking are shedding. He is in deep
and
the hole, and he is down.
So
both teams
have lost their Scimitars now. There is no logistics on the field. Now it's up to Harpy, primary now for PL. They're trying to kill off the frigates for Hydra Reloaded. Meanwhile, it looks like we got a web on the Vulture there for PL and some damage onto the Hawk. We'll have to see which ship, Harpy already down, which ship Hydra primaries with all their damage right away.
Damage is slow applying, though, to the PL team.
A little bit strange this isn't by Pandemic Legion to primary these harpies instead of going for damage. What do you think about this?
I think they want to get the tackle off the field so that they can get their, well, for these, their smaller ships, get the transversal.
But now Gila by Amber Saint is tackled now and neuted. He must be right in there with their Shadowless.
There you go. So that's two harpies down.
Gabarius, Rattlesnake of Pandemic Legion, is now taking damage. He is in half shields, taking serious damage.
He has both of these claymores right on top of him. He is not able to rep through this.
The Rattlesnake is now falling into red. Shortly
going into... If that Rattlesnake goes away, that's going to be a lot of the damage off the field. It looks like they're actually trying to get some damage onto the Claymore of Hard SP and also onto the heel of Amber Saint. No, all right, there you go. Most of it's on the heel of Amber Saint. Amber Saint is going down, but it looks like Admiral Gabarius will go down around the same time, and that is a good trade for Hyde to reload.
That is an absolutely good trade. Aquila for a Rattlesnake is a trade that you should and could and absolutely have to take. However, the Gila belonging to Amber Saint goes
down,
before...
Admiral Scopolis is in structure.
And he is
in
trouble, and he is
down. All right, so now
that
the next
Gila... That is a massive
Gila.
Chunk of Pandemic Legion damage.
We've got another Gila now tackled by the frigates for PL, so that's where their next damage is going to be applied to. Meanwhile, the Rattlesnake of Hands is under a lot of fire as well. I think this Gila is going to go down a lot faster than the Rattlesnake just because of the huge amount of buffer these Rattlesnakes have, but... one way or another, once the Gilas go off the field and the Rattlesnakes go off the field, there's a lot more damage on the Hydra team from those two claymores.
That's right, absolutely. The Gila belonging to a name I cannot pronounce is now falling into armor. It is in structure. It is absolutely going
Hans
to die here.
Tanky
very
for a long time.
Hans is hanging on there. He's absolutely hanging
there's
on
there. There's tackle right away on Rakamar. Now, for these Gilas for Hydra Reloaded, what they needed to do was get far away, spread out. They're dropping their sentry runes. They don't need to be anywhere near this field. The fact that they got tackled so fast is really, really bad news for them. Good piloting by the PL frigates, bad piloting by the Hydra Reloaded.
However, this Rattlesnake belonging to Hans is now in trouble. He is in low shields. He is probably on ASP.
PL needs to kill this
Gila
before they lose the Rattlesnake, but it doesn't mean that's
going to
happen.
If this Gila hangs on just long enough for this Rattlesnake to die, and the Rattlesnake
I cannot call who's
going to
win this fight. This is going to be the Rattlesnake and Gila are going to die around the same time, it looks like. Wow.
That's right. But that is a massive, massive chunk of damage gone from Pandemic Legion's side. It's going to be close here.
There we go. And they both explode. Well, the Gila's gone. Rattlesnake is going to be falling in just a moment. It looks like they're going to try to pick off the frigates first. We are going to see an entire wing of assault frigates versus two claymores.
Wow.
He's pulling back some shield, though.
He's pulling back. He's probably got
did he get a reload?
ESP,
I'm going to watch.
Can he pull it off?
If he's going to do it. No, he's going to die.
Hans is down. Both Rattlesnakes on Pandemic Legion side now down with Hydra reloaded. Only with two Claymores, Stiletto, and two Merlins.
Now,
it looks like
Hydra
Pandemic Legion
needs
goes
to kill
for
these
frigates. Absolutely. Hydra reloaded. Technically could lose here on points if they do not kill these harpies fast enough. Tycoonian in a harpy, however, has been caught. He is swept, and he is taking heavy fire, and he is going to go down. That is one.
So, and another harpy is tackled. Very, very importantly, killing that harpy will put Hydra up on points.
It looks like Pandemic Legion remaining frigates have chosen to stay on this claymore. They're going to try to burn down Hearts.
I cannot but feel
that this is a bad, bad decision on Pandemic Legion's side. They are going to lose this because his claymores are right on top of them. And his Claymore can and will tank them.
Hart SP and his Claymore does have an ASB running. However, he can't have too many more charges left on it. So we're going to keep an eye on how long he boosts and how long... I think he's done. I don't see a boost on him.
Yeah.
He's going into armor.
Hart SP
he's not
has
boosting.
Now run out of his boost.
If they kill this, they're going to be so far ahead on points. They can just run the frigates away. Oh, wow. All right, the damage...
But the Harpy now has gone.
Flycatcher now tackles the Flycatcher as well. That Claymore of Hard SP is moving. He is moving far away. The damage has turned a lot off him. He is down into structure, but the damage has slowed down so much.
And he might here be able to reload his ASP.
It's
going to
be close. There,
he explodes. Down.
All right, PL is now up by, 5 points here. 5 points ahead for PL. If they can avoid the Claymore, I don't think the Merlins and Stiletto can kill.
Right.
Oh, Hawk is tackled. Hawk of
Shameless
Orzhov
is tackled. But so is Raimo in a Stiletto. I feel like Pandemic Legion needs to go here for the Frick tackles. They need to clear off these Frickets, and then they need to cut away as far as possible from this Claymore. This Vulture, of course,
Shameless
is going
does not
to
have the Claymore
slow.
On him yet. Shameless does not have the Claymore on him yet. It's the Stiletto that has him tackled. If they can take down these frigs, they can just kite for the rest of the match and win on points.
Right, and Seamus Orsos is no longer tackled. He is now free
and the
to
Stiletto
move
of Raimo,
the steel
mild
of Raimo is
by
dead.
The way.
What a match. Hydra reloaded, left with a single claymore, two Merlins, while
Hydra
Legion
needs
has
to catch these frigs.
Three
also,
hawks, a hook,
Hydra
and a
could,
vulture.
They've got 4 minutes. They could kill this vulture. Potentially.
They could. Potentially they could. It depends if that Vulture is ASP fit or not. Danko is a fairly good pilot here. What he will be doing is trying to move as far away from the Claymore as possible.
He's like 90 clicks away from the Claymore right now. He's a long... You'll see him on your screen. He's the one right up at the top there. He's doing exactly the right thing. He's going to slide some of this down. So it looks like the Vulture is going to be the only thing that Hydra can catch. Everyone else is too fast. Unless they make big piloting mistakes, then only the Merlins will be able to catch these frigs. That means they need to burn down a Vulture in 3 minutes 27 seconds. I don't know if they can do that with only a Claymore and two Merlins.
No, this seems to go currently on Pandemic Legion's way. If they can kill these Merlins here fairly fast with these Hawks while managing to avoid tackle on this Vulture, it all now comes down to how good of a pilot Dunkel 101 is. Early on in the day and early in the match, CCP Dolan said that Dunkel is the worst pilot in BO and worst player of SE2.
Dunkel did lose an Adestia today.
He did indeed. Now, the Merlin of Ice Helia is
in structure.
But the
Hawk of Sheamus is also taking a lot of damage. Looks like
Sheamus has been caught. He has been, well, he's not tackled,
but it looks like the Merlin
is taking quite a lot of damage. The Merlin of Ice Helia here is in structure, but he is now kiting away. He is MWDing away, and he goes down. This leaves only a single Merlin on the Hydro Reloaded side that can potentially be fast enough to tackle. This Garmin
Garmin is chasing down the Vulture. Garmin, in his Claymore, is not going after the frigs. He is after that Vulture. His goal is going to be to overload, take down the Vulture, hope that it has a fairly weak tank. It's possible. If it's if the four-link Vulture and has a command processor, it could have a very weak tank.
Yes,
also,
absolutely.
Dankel is incredibly close to the arena edge there.
Now, the question is, of course, even if he manages to kill this Vulture, is that enough points?
Let's see here. Four. It'll be tied.
We don't know who's going to win.
If
that's how close this is. 2 minutes remaining of the match.
If the Vulture
dies, Dunkel 101 is now webbed. He is webbed by this Claymore. The Claymore has gotten on top of it.
But
he
will it be
right
to kill him? 1 minute 52 seconds.
1 minute 52 seconds. Will he have enough damage to kill him?
They're right on the edge of the arena. They also possibly, might try to bump him out of the arena.
Absolutely. But the thing to watch out here is, does this Vulture have an ASP or not?
Yep.
Will he be boosting or not? Do we see boost effects going on the Vulture?
We haven't yet seen
101?
Boost effects on him. Haven't yet seen. But he is going down so slowly. Do you know what this may be? Like, if this Claymore was a Slapnir, then that
Claymore
would win.
Getting quite a lot of damage on him as well.
Yeah, blaster and the Vulture. You know what? If this Claymore was a Slapnir, then this Vulture.
The Vulture just boosted. The Vulture just boosted.
He's got
has an ASP.
He's going
to
be
there
fine.
There is no way in 1 minute 15 seconds
now,
that the Hydro Reload is
able
to break
very
through this
close to arena edge. But other than an arena violation, I think we're about to see Pandemic Legion winning the 11th Alliance tournament
and
in a
Garmin,
squeaker.
Perhaps
Garmin,
a sweet,
the leader,
sweet symphony,
the leader
Pandemic
of
Legion
the Hydro Reloaded Alliance,
the leader of the Hydro Reloaded here to be the last one to witness the utter humiliation.
All right,
the
Dankel
Pandemic
is still
Legion
taking
has
some damage,
put on Hydro Reloaded,
but I don't think it's going to be enough. I really don't think it's going to be enough. Now, as I was saying before, we saw this is the setup that they copied it from Exodus. However, the Exodus version had a Slapnir.
Correct. So somehow, Pandemic Legion must have.
But if Garmin was a Slapnir, he probably would have been able to kill the Vulture, because that's
correct.
Twice the DPS.
Correct. They went onto this match about 1/5 of their DPS down simply
that's
by that Slapnir.
And that's, I think that
ban
may have swung it. We may have actually seen a situation where it came down to the bans banning out the exact ship they were trying to field, and that swung this entire match. That was enough for this razor thin match to turn it around.
And Claymore
15
off
seconds
Garmin
left.
Is
it's possible
trouble,
he might die one way or another.
Left.
It doesn't matter.
Wow.
This is going
match
to be a Pandemic Legion victory in the 11th Alliance Tournament. The last tournament they won was the 8th Alliance Tournament. It's been a couple years.
Sheamus Orzaz, back after 2 years of a losing streak, wanting to show the rest of the odds how it's done. And he has done it. Congratulations to Pandemic Legion and Sheamus Orzaz.
That is it. Garmin will survive, but that doesn't matter. That is the end of Alliance Tournament 11. Fifth match of a best 3 out of 5. Pandemic Legion,
amazing.
3 matches to 2, has been victorious after already losing yesterday in their own series to Hydro Reloaded, coming back through the losers bracket.
What a comeback.
That is unbelievable. Wow.
Oh, my God.
Congratulations to both of these teams. These two teams are both really, really coming out of this very rich. They're both getting 50 prize ships, so they got to be happy about that.
Pandemic Legion has the bragging rights here by beating Hydro Reloaded, being 2 wins down. They came back the underdog of this match. Congratulations. Well done, guys. And with that, we're going to bazz you back to Soundwave. We'll be right back.
get the elite while waiting for a prey to put its shiny port into his career. So you know he's let jump, jump, and let the booty hit the floor, and that is how the boom boom.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to this next match in the 12th Alliance Tournament. This is CCB Fozzie, joined by Bacchanalian to finish off this day for you all. And we have the Ronin versus Hydra Reloaded. And on your screen in front of you, you see the Hydra flagship for the first time having emerged from the darkness. That is the rattlesnake that Hydra has been holding this whole time. And they've brought it out alongside a really strong DPS team. Triple Sleipnir, Scimitar, Double Mollus, Stiletto, Triple Merlin, and Slasher. Why don't you tell us a bit about this Ronin team?
Well, we see a Ronin team that's warped entirely into zero. We have a Golem, Double Rattlesnake, Claymore, three Maledictions, and three Crows. So a lot of tackle, a fair bit of DPS put into very few baskets here. There were two Rattlesnakes and a Golem, the Claymore. And it looks like the Rattlesnakes had no missile launchers we determined, so they're probably cap transferring in some sort of quasi-tinker. And it looks like Hydra's also was not tracking disruptors.
So the Frigs from the Ronin have charged right on in. They're getting tackles as quickly as they can. And they put track disruptors on all the Sleipnirs. These are autocannon Sleipnirs. These aren't the artillery ones we saw earlier in the tournament. But the tracking circuit is still going to be incredibly effective, and a web on that scimitar is huge, along with the painter from the golem.
It's going to be a lot of damage coming into that scimitar right away. Dark Soldat's going to have to do some work here. Webs on Malediction and a Crow simultaneously. In the meanwhile, they're going to try to get that Malediction off the scimitar.
Dark Soldat is surrounded by four frigates right now. They're not getting the web off of him.
Yep. Mollus down. Ace Hellia. That looked like he was instant. Was that perhaps a boundary?
Yes, that was a boundary violation.
Boundary violation Ace from Hydra.
Wow. All right. The Malediction has died. The first one. They're trying to clear the
tower. The
Crow
is going to get cleared as well, it looks like. But the Scimitar is going to eventually run into ASB Reload, and he will go down here with this amount of damage on him if they don't clear out this tackle right away.
The Scimitar does have remote shield bots on him, so that's partly what's keeping him alive this long. But he is ASBing as well. And once that ASB
he
goes
did
into
break
Reload,
web. There is no web on Dark Soldat. He is getting up to speed. Hopefully, maybe not up to speed yet.
No, he's still got some frigs around him. It looks like they're going to be trying
maybe
to get
he's
a, he might have a scram on him.
Yeah.
All right, they are still clearing out these frigs. Another Malediction is going to be dropping any moment now for Ronin. Hydra is honestly the only thing they've lost, even after all this, is that one Mollus that boundary violated. They have been doing basically a great job of clearing off this tackle right on through.
Well, that Scimitar Dark Soldat dropping into armor. He may be on ASB Reload right now, taking a whole bunch of damage, and he can't take armory rage. Going into structure.
He's being hit by the drones from Rattlesnake.
Structure is
cruise missiles.
Gone!
That is Dark Soldat for Hydra Reloaded down. Now we see a Golem, two Rattlesnakes, they're not flagships, and a Claymore for Ronin versus the Flaggle Snake for Hydra, Triple Sleipnir, Mollus Stiletto, Triple Merlin Slasher. This honestly could still go either way. We're going to have to see how well strong the tanks of these Rattlesnakes are. I assume that's going to be the next primary for Hydra.
I feel like if you're the Ronin going into this match and they tell you you can trade your frigate wing for a Hydra Reloaded logistics, they might consider that trade. That is a pretty big trade because now they can freely apply their DPS. I mean, the three Sleipnirs and the Rattlesnake's going to tank like crazy, and they know that. But the three Sleipnirs will have to go into ASB Reload. And if these Rattlesnakes and Golem and Claymore can survive long enough to actually get them to that point, they're going to break each one every time.
So Valk is not boosting as right now. He may be passive tank. He may be just holding back his ASB, but he's also holding on quite well. The damage from the entire Hydra team has been hitting him, and you can see barely being even touched. Now they're switching over to Claymore. They're going to see if that's a weaker target.
Claymore is neutered, Nost, and web down. He broke webs there. Somebody dropped the web off of him. We do see newts coming across the team. So there's a newt also on Braggle's Rattlesnake. Meanwhile, a newt on the Sleipnir of DHB Wildcat. It looks like he's about to go into armor while this Claymore also is dropping into armor.
DHB Wildcat is surrounded by Infiltrator 2s, and he is dropping very quickly. Acolyte 2s as well. But it looks like that the Claymore for Ronin, which is all of their links, is going to be dropping off the field first.
I think so. But that's if they can trade that Sleipnir here pretty quickly. That Sleipnir to low armor, DHB Wildcat about to be in the structure. Two Rattlesnakes to go.
DHB Wildcat is still not boosting. He is going to go down. It's only a matter
He's
of seconds
toast.
Now. And there he goes. He is off the field.
What
so now,
a match, a 1-point match with three battleship hulls against two Sleipnirs, Rattlesnake in support. What's going to happen?
Wow, Rackham Artist took a huge chunk of damage here. He is being hit very, very hard. We're seeing him getting neuted by the Golem and Rattlesnake.
Did see a boost effect from Vok 3's Rattlesnake there now. So he is using his ASB, perhaps just waiting on it. But they got Sleipnir of Rackham Artist dropping really, really low.
Wow.
Really low. He is still boosting, but he's not bringing back very much right now.
This is, all right. Valk is dropping, but he's not dropping fast enough. If Rackamar could drop first, then the Ronin's going to be in a really, really great position with only the Flaggle Snake and the Sleipnir able to do damage for the entire Ronin team. Then they can, that Golem is more points than the Rattlesnake for Hydra. If they can keep the Golem alive, even if they lose both the Rattlesnakes and wipe out the rest of the team, then they win on points.
And that Rackamar is pulling back his shields for now, so he has recovered some of his tank. But I wonder, is he's going to go into reload before long. If that Rattlesnake is still tanking for Vok 3, by the time that happens, Ronin will have a significant advantage in this match.
Rakamar has been pulling range to get away from these newts. It actually looks like he may have given up on that because he's turning back a little bit, but he's not able to stay away from the drones. He still has the whole drone wave from the entire Ronin team on him. And he is dropping down. He's not boosting. He's in armor, though. Wow, I think the Slapnir is probably going to die first, but it is so close here. That's going to be... The Rattlesnake is going to die. Vok is going to die to the remaining Rattlesnake and Slapnir. But can a Rattlesnake, a Slap, or even a flagship Rattlesnake, a Slapnir, and a bunch of frigates take down a Golem and a Rattlesnake?
This is unbelievable. Sure that Vok 3 is still pulling back
boosting
shields.
Again. He reloaded. He reloaded his ASB, and he is boosting again, and now there's one less Slapnir shooting him.
But he's about to bleed into structure. He's going to bleed into structure. Is he able to hold on long enough here?
Every second he can survive, though, means more damage being applied to the final
target
Slapnir
on Blue Melon.
Oh, all right. Vok is holding on through structure. He's still boosting. He is going to go into reload again soon. So again, he is going to die.
But that Slapnir is melting right through his tank. I mean, wow.
This, just as a reminder for anyone that doesn't understand the context of this, this is hard reloaded up against the wall. The loser of this is out of the tournament. This is incredible. I don't think anyone was expecting the Ronin to put up this much of a fight.
So Rattlesnake right. for Vok 3 is down, but you still have Rattlesnake and a Golem against a Slapnir and a Rattlesnake. Slapnir will be an ASB reload yep. probably in about another 3 or 4 boosts here.
So Blue Melon is continuing to orbit in really close to this whole team for Ronin. He's in nice and close. He's going to pull a bit of range now because he knows he's got the newts coming, but I don't think he's going to be able to get out before they can get at least a couple of newt cycles on him.
No, I think he would have to get completely out of range before his ASB reloads. So we have a web now on Braggle's Rattlesnake, obviously the next primary, but we'll see. Is he going to be able to hold on to this damage?
So as this match gets longer, one of the things that's going to actually matter quite a lot is that flagship Rattlesnake flown by Hard SB. He's been neutering the Golem and the remaining Rattlesnakes for Ronin this whole match. Blue Melon dropping so quickly. Wow.
Almost into armor here. This is a big deal because Braggle's not taking any damage right now. He's not boosting. He's into armor. The Slapnir goes down. It's a Rattlesnake against a Rattlesnake and a Golem.
This is incredible. The only chance I can imagine the Hydra having here is if that flagship Rattlesnake can cap out the Hardeners on one of these ships.
Blue Melon is now into structure.
Blue Melon
will
go down. Blue
Melon
is going to drop. He's moving away as quickly as he can, but it's not going to be enough. He's in structure. He's still surrounded with drones, and he's down.
And he's gone. Absolutely unbelievable. Ronin are hanging on here. In fact, Roland may have this match under control. Merlin of Suetona now dropping into low armor. He is looks like he's going to be next. Ronin figure, let's pick off the support. We don't even need to bother with the flagship.
Even if Hydra can somehow kill the Rattlesnake of Braggle, they still need to actually kill that Golem, because the Golem can finish off the Fricks.
They don't have the DPS to do it.
And that... The only way is if these newts do it, but I really doubt it. It looks like we're about to see the Ronin in a gigantic upset knocking Hydra Reloaded out of this tournament.
Not that much of an upset. They did beat Rokapel after
They did beat Rokapel. they have an incredible team. And this is, of course, like this Ronin team is one of the most storied teams in tournament history. We've actually seen the Nulli
Merlin
team.
Down.
The Nulli team that was filled with a lot of these pilots that had been involved in all the Hun victories. And this Ronin team is, again, a team that has been around since they came in second to the third Alliance tournament.
And another
Merlin
down. The Rattlesnake and Braggle now actually starting to take some appreciable damage. He may just be kind of not boosting.
He's in about half shield, and he is, he's taking quite a bit of damage. Again,
still got Hardener's on, though. Looks like despite the newts, there's
Hardener effects on him. This flagship Rattlesnake of Hard SP is going to be doing a ton of damage.
It's guaranteed to be officer fit. Yeah.
For anyone that's not familiar with the flagship rules, flagships are a ship that not only can't be banned, but also you can fit a lot of modules that you wouldn't be allowed to otherwise. Officer and faction modules in especially newts and E-War and some remote reapers and damage mods, which
now,
is huge.
Here's the trick. If this Rattlesnake at Braggle goes down, the Golem needs to pick off a frigate.
Yes.
Period.
So he's going for Kaddish now.
Or a Stiletto needs to die to make the points difference, because the Golem is 26 points, the Rattlesnake is 20. These frigates are 4 and 3 respectively, so it would be a 1-point win for Hydra if these two frigates survive and the Golem is the only thing remaining for Ronin.
So right now, Braggle is going into armor. He is going to drop. He's got geckos from the Flaggle Snake from Hydra. He has a web drone that he is sending out after
onto
the frigates.
There's a web drone on Heart SPs. Actually, the Stiletto just... Does he boundary violate there?
The Stiletto boundary violated!
An absolute throw from Kadesh
Princess.
Oh my
god! Boundary violated! Pretty much handing the Ronin this win, because there's no way that the Rattlesnake kills a Golem in 1 minute.
That was the match, because if he stays alive and that Mollus now goes down, stays alive, they kill this Rattlesnake with a minute left. They might be able to win.
Do you know what it also could have been? The Mollus also boundary violated. It's possible that they did this on purpose as well, knowing that they had already lost at that point, thinking that they couldn't keep up. It seems like they would at least try, though, at that point.
But they're so close, they were within 1 point of possibly winning if they keep those frigates alive.
But that, all right. So, the last Rattlesnake gone for the Ronin. It is now Golem versus Rattlesnake.
crucially, the golem is worth more points than a rattlesnake. So this means both these ships are going to survive. We've only got a minute left. There's no way either of them are going to die unless they somehow jump out of the arena. And Gargaris there for the Ronin is staying in Bastion to make sure that doesn't happen. We are about to see the Ronin moving on, knocking Hydra Reloaded out of Alliance Tournament 12.
So the Ronin are going to actually have to go on to fight Tuskers today.
Yes. So they're going to, right after this match, be ready to go in like two matches for now. But they've got to have to be on a huge high.
Oh, they're riding the adrenaline from this all the way.
Amazing, amazing high.
30 seconds left. Gargus is taking quite a bit of damage. He's the half shield.
He's not boosting at all. I haven't seen a single boost from him. There he goes. There's the big boost. Okay. So he has. So he was just trolling a little bit.
With 20 seconds left. As this match obviously is going nowhere, I'm going to quickly say happy birthday to my wife, who was kind enough to let me fly to Iceland to do this on her birthday. So, congratulations to Ronin. Hydra is going to be out of this tournament in an unbelievable turn of events, going to the loser's bracket last time. Losing two straight. Who saw that? Two out of three.
Yeah.
Who saw that coming? Really? I mean, unbelievable.
No, I was not expecting that. And they did bring in an excellent setup. They brought out the flagship. They brought out a lot of damage. And that is the match. That is the Ronin over Hydra Reloaded in an elimination match. And we are now going to send you back to the guys at the desk.
Reap is your f***ing primary! Reap is the f***ing primary! Everyone the f***ing Reap in now!
Go for Tower Wars, free for all. Tower Wars.
Absolutely, a massive amount of damage being spread.
Absolutely,
just absolutely. That the Oneros is taking chunks and chunks of damage. Massive damage, and I can't tell what's going on. Taking massive chunks of damage. Massive.
Flagships die.
Dropping like flies. Absolutely.
Like,
a massive amount of damage. Massive amount. The second Vindicator is just melting like butter. And whoever betted against them is right now smiling, as I usually do when I'm talking to Michael Bolton in the studio. Absolutely. The mass of eating dirt from all of... Look at the chunks. Wow, what do you think about that? Massive, massive chunks and chunk. That's right.
Ooh, look, I'm at the edge of the graphics.
Yeah, there's a lot of really big teams there.
Yeah, I don't quite what's going on. Absolutely.
Here we go.
I Rodok Bell shows who's the boss here. They nude stuff.
Zyperians.
Wow. Shoot me. Eating dirt. No, absolutely. Massive. That's right. Being hammered. Absolutely. Absolutely. Of course. Massive. He screamed and begged and cried. He is able to grab transfer this basilisk. Absolutely. Wow. Chunks. Wow. Wow. And he is dead. Massive. Eating it fast.
Yeah.
Massive damage! Fast! And dead! Wow! Massive chunks of- Wow!
Yeah. Unbelievable! We're gonna send you back to Soundwave and the guys in the studio for their reaction.
If you, there's like a leak or something, like, just jam it in there.
Is that the slappy chop one?
Whoa! Wow!
Massive! There he's
gone!
He's
dead! Wow. He's down! But he's able to still rep.
He's going
melting.
To go down! He's now
webbed! Now he's webbed! Absolutely! Wow, massive chunk. This is crucial.
Only dogs are allowed to wear helmets in tournaments like these.
The
absolutely. Shot at the
massive chunks.
Right.
Whoa!
There it goes!
Oh, Second Daytona down!
Second Daytona down!
Massively up as well.
You know
and
what?
And dinosaurs.
Absolutely. Massive. Actually.
So now we have TCB Rise. He's never liked anything this fun. That's just why he also loves ECM more than anything else in the world. Every time I try to nerf ECM, he says, no, Fozzie.
Wow! Look at that. Brutix fly! CCP Dolan once again proving he doesn't know anything about this game. Massive, absolutely. Massive. Slipping through and he is gone! Yes. We all think he is absolutely terrible at Eve.
And the Armageddon picked up a drone damage bonus as well as a neutralizer range bonus. Wow.
Crucially, absolutely. It's is taking mass crucially crucial amount of damage off the field. Meanwhile, massively. Crucially, however, this will be truly crucial. Crucial. I am Shadu. I'm here with CCP Fozzy. I'm wearing my shirt. And there are, The Tengu, however, is breaking! The Tengu is breaking!
They could still break that Tengu. Then I think that Tengu will break.
He's
in low shield again. So this Tengu...
But he's now webbed, scrambled. Wait, but when he
moves... Into armor, though.
I think this Tengu will fall. Crucial amount of... And I believe this Tengu will fall. The Tengu going... No! Kill the Tengu! Kill the Tengu! The Tengu falling
Tengu dropping
again.
Low again.
New pressure.
Armor hack! Wow!
Right, this Tengu, though, is going to die. There is no question in my mind about that. Massive, crucial armor.
I need to go change my shirt and perhaps my pants as well.
Hello there, this is Apophany with CCP Fozzy here. Quick update on the last match, the TNT Simi did in fact have a 5 meganewton MWD rather than a 50 meganewton MWD.
So now we know
MWD.
Why he got caught.
Now we know he got... Anyway, now we have an amazing match, Shadow Cartel versus Gorgon Empire. Shadow Cartel being badasses of the highest order with Double Nightmare. With Claymore, Scimitar, Double Jackdaw, Swipple, Manticore, two of those, two Nemesis, and a Vigil for those
Meanwhile,
paints.
A much more normal setup from Gorgon Empire with Double Navy Scorp, Claymore, Scimitar, and then lots of Tech 3 Destroyers and Bombers. This, I think, is going to be really awesome to see what Shadow Cartel can do with the Nightmares. This is a really good team. They've been piloting well, and Nightmares, I really enjoy them. They haven't been the strongest traditionally in Alliance tournaments, though this year they've done okay.
I mean, nobody's bringing Tracking Disruptors.
They're going, no one's bringing Tracking Disruptors, and they go right into the resist hole of those Navy Scorpions, so I am excited to see what these guys do. They are Mega Pulse fit Navy Scorpions against Rapid Heavy Missile Navy, or Rapid Heavy Missile Navy Scorpions, Mega Pulse fit Nightmares, and the teams have warped in, kind of spread out, so we've actually got only about a 40 kilometer range between the battleships. The match has now begun, and immediately we're going to see...
Ripple of Gremp burning straight in, round the back, looks like he's going to try and circle back to the
Remember what we just said about Tracking Disruptors? It looks like
People
Gorgon Empire did bring Tracking Disruptors. That's bad news for Shadow Cartel.
Bad news. For the Nightmare. There does seem to be only one, but half of their Nightmares not being able to apply damage is a really big deal.
However, both Logis already scrammed and webbed. This is going to be a real test to see if they can get him down faster. I think that Tracking Disruptor on the Nightmare is really going to hurt Shadow Cartel.
EM thermal damage into Scimitar T2 resists from the Nightmare is really not going well, and it shows the Shadow Cartel Logis straight away, straight down.
All right, so we are probably going to see the Scimitar for Gorgon follow, but in the meantime, they can probably get a couple of these Bombers down, and if they do, they're going to be off to a huge lead. As we see already, a Painter onto that first Manticore, that's a great for next primary. They're going to try to knock him down quickly. They got to get him down, I think, before the Scimitar drops to really take advantage of this lead.
Yeah, I mean, as you said, the Gorgon Empire Scimitar is most likely going to drop, but it's taking so long to die. This gives Gorgon so much time to do work on the AS Scimitar. They've caught a Manticore and it's down. They're now a Bomber ahead.
They are only one Bomber ahead, though, so that's actually very good piloting from the Shadow Cartel Bomber.
The Bombers are cool, though.
Yeah, now they've got the tackle on all of them. We're going to see how quickly these Feeples and Jackdaws and can just burn through. But we'll see.
Double TDs now on the Nightmares. Looks like the pilots must have been applying both to the same one and got a bit mixed up, but they corrected that now. Whoa, Bombers dropping like flies here.
Yeah, this is a really, really strong point for Gorgon Empire. They're just in great shape. Those Tracking Disruptors, not something we've seen from a lot of teams. The Gorgon Empire, though, maybe just bringing them as an insurance policy, potentially worried about Sleipnirs, which is something that could be an issue for this team. But they hit the jackpot, basically, coming up against Nightmares with the Tracking Disruptors.
Yeah, we've even got a jam being attempted on the Nightmare now. Gorgon have just taken apart the heavy support of the Shadow Cartel team. In order to take out those heavy tanking Navy Scorpions and even the Claymore in any amount of time, they needed that insane Bomber DPS.
Yep.
They do not have it anymore. So even without the Logi, it would take Shadow Cartel an age to take out the Gorgon top end, and Gorgon are just burning through the Shadow Cartel team like it's not even there. Now painting a Jackdaw, that's taking a ton of damage, and really strong showing from Gorgon. They won their first game only an hour ago. you know, two games in, an hour and a half apart, and two wins. Yep. Great showing here from Gorgon.
It does look like it's the Jackdaws with the tracking disruptors. So that's a nice use of the extra mid slots on the Jackdaw there. Yeah, just a really clever utility choice. And that, I think, is going to be one of the things. There's also just great execution. Fast tackle on the Scimitar. Really good tackle on the Bombers. But those tracking disruptors are really, I think, the early story of this match.
Yeah, I mean, Shadow Cartel are actually in the lead at the moment by points. They are a point ahead on Gorgon Empire. They're taking down their second Jackdaw, getting those TDs off their nightmares.
Gonna be very
Do you
helpful.
Think they could swing it back?
So the four Bombers still sitting there for Gorgon Empire are going to be huge when they move into killing the large ships.
We're
seeing
that
nightmare dropping very quickly.
So quickly.
It really is, I think. Like, yes, the points look very even, but this is still Shadow Cartel in a big deficit. These nightmares would have to be real heroes, I think, to be able to pull it off at this point. They are going to kill some Bombers. That Sveeple is doing a good job of getting tackle on one of them. I think unless that nightmare can survive much longer, he's got an ASB.
He's found some tank from somewhere, for sure. Probably an ASB. I mean, it's worth mentioning
Shadow
Cartel.
A couple of Shield Rep drones, too.
Ooh, Shadow Cartel are in fact taking out the Bombers now, leaving it to be a top end versus top end.
All right, here's what I'm confused about. Yeah. That Bomber was like 10 kilometers from the nightmare. The Bomber had burned like right in there and got right into
just
like...
Not a great choice with the tracking bonus ship.
Really. Maybe he was trying to get under the guns, but then he just got webbed and couldn't keep up transversal. This nightmare tanking has brought this match back to being in contention.
Yeah, but Shadow Cartel 10 points ahead
does
now.
Have the lead, but of course that nightmare, if he drops now, then that's going to put them far back again.
There is just an ungodly amount of EHP on top of a Scorpion. With that resist bonus, it means all those cost so much more. Nightmare into armor, big top end ship going from Shadow Cartel here.
We need to, this nightmare, do you know what could do really well right now? A hull tank would be amazing. A good bump to get out of scram range, and then maybe a micro jump. But unfortunately, I don't think he's going to be able to get that. He's going to go down. And so now it's going to be one Nightmare, Claymore, Sveeple, and Vigil against two Navy Scorpions and a Claymore. Still not completely out of the realm of possibility for Shadow Cartel to take
this
back.
If the Navy Scorpions didn't think they'd got primary and had tons of Eeyore in their mids instead, then possibly...
This Navy Scorpion is dropping pretty fast.
It is.
Like, he is already down to half shield. So this is going to be... What we need is Nasty Spanker, another one of my all-time favorite tournament names.
Absolutely.
To really be a hero here. He has to outbrawl this nightmare hardcore. There's a lot of rep drones on the Scorpion Navy issue. That's going to be a challenge because he's going to be tanking pretty well with that. But we'll see how well.
Gorgon have caught a Sveeple, and it looks like they're trying to get DPS on it and failing. I'm not really seeing any DPS being applied from Gorgon to Shadow at this moment.
Yeah, the Sveeple is what's tackling the Navy Scorpion there, so that's why they're kind of
DPS on it. I really want to know what Shadow Cartel is shooting at the moment. Maybe the Navy Scorpion, but doesn't seem to be going that well.
I think
they
may be on reload. I'm not seeing missiles coming from the Scorpion right now. It may just be a matter of time, because again, these are rapid heavy. All right, they're going on the Sveeple. They're trying to burn the Sveeple down, freeing themselves up. Potentially, they might be micro jump drive fit, which would be very helpful in a match like this. If one of the Navy Scorpions gets low, they'd be able to bounce out. But that Sveeple is dropping pretty quickly. He's got some rep drones on him. It's not going to be enough. Like, Shadow Cartel actually performing really well here. I'm amazed at how long that first nightmare survived, but it is going to be very difficult for one Nightmare, Claymore, and a Vigil to turn this around at this point.
Yeah, I mean, last year Shadow Cartel had a fantastic showing in the loser's bracket after narrowly losing to PL. I mean, and they pushed PL. It was a really close match down to the final seconds of Pike's EO surviving. Yep. And they've gone through this tournament. They've done really, really well. They've got to the final weekend, which is a huge achievement no matter which alliance you are. And even though they're losing to the Gorgon Spawn here today, Shadow Cartel should absolutely be really proud of what they managed to accomplish this year.
All right, so we have, at this point, a bunch of ECM drones dropped by the Gorgon guys. They're trying to just kind of reduce the DPS, keep the Navy Scorpion alive. But that Navy Scorpion is dropping faster. He's burning away now. He does have a micro warp drive, and he's getting some distance. But of course, the Nightmares can just switch to Scorch and still apply well.
Nightmares, bonus to afterburner speed, fairly recent change, means that if they're afterburning and they're not webbed, I mean, the scram's just stopping an MJD here, it means that they will, to some extent, mitigate damage from the rapid heavy Navy Scorch. I mean, not a lot, but every little helps in this circumstance.
Yeah. Now, Nasty Spanker's not moving very fast. He may actually not have an afterward fit. He might have decided they needed something else for that slot.
I mean, here we go, up to actually 700, pushing up to 800
meters a second. As I say that, he turns it on. So what he's doing now is he's chasing after Pandy. Pandy did a great job of getting away. That's why we saw him kind of pull back. He was down into very low shields. He got some distance. It looks like it took a couple seconds there for Nasty Spanker to be able to get his afterburner on, get close. But now he's catching up. So
reload is done. Nasty Spanker taking a ton of damage here. Probably gave Pandy enough time to reload his ASB. I mean, there was, you know,
potentially, yeah. I mean, he's not boosting right now, but he's just sitting in a much higher shield situation than Nasty Spanker is at the moment. This is some really good battleship piloting from both teams, but good work controlling range by these Scorpion Navy issues.
If Shadow Cartel, if that Nightmare can survive until the next reload, which I don't think it will, perhaps could he take down a Navy Scorpion and even it up? Perhaps, maybe, possibly?
It's within the realm of possibility. Remember, he is going right into the damage hole of the Navy Scorpions, and they've got the Claymore right on top of the primary. This Scorpion may go down, but I really don't think that Nasty Spanker's boosting again. He did get a reload off.
Hey, that is huge. Nasty Spanker.
If this Navy Scorpion goes down before the Nightmare, then we are back to having a real match on our hands.
Oh, this is Shadow
There's
Cartel.
Only 1 minute and 23 seconds left. So if they can kill the Navy Scorpion, then the Vigil gives them the points.
It does.
The Vigil plus the Nightmare having more points worth it by itself.
I mean, the Navy Scorpion must be reloading ASB.
Yep.
That Nightmare needs to overheat for his life here. He's got to pray that he's got thermo 5 drained.
Pandy's probably only a few seconds away from being able to boost again. This is really coming down to whether Pandy's
come on, Shadow Cartel
turns itself on again. Nasty Spanker applying his damage.
Down into structure.
He's really low, but he is also pulling away. There's no tackle on him, so he's getting some good distance. Warp scramble attempt.
Nasty Spanker has
got a warp scramble on the Navy Scorpion. That's huge. Oh, it dropped it again, but that maybe has been enough.
I mean,
it's got to be only seconds away. 37 seconds left.
Moving.
If Pandy survives,
going down into structure, is the Navy Scorp gonna die?
If Pandy survives for 30 seconds, then they win the match. Otherwise, Shadow Cartel will take it.
Navy Scorpion's in low structure. Navy Scorpion is in structure.
He just needs like one boost, and maybe he can make it. The Navy Scorpion is like, what? There he goes. 21
Shadow
seconds
Cartel
left.
Get ahead in points in the last 20 seconds of the match.
That is Shadow Cartel. Unless that Nightmare goes out of the arena, that is the match. Wow, I had pretty much written Shadow Cartel off. They had lost that scimitar really quickly early on.
No one is near the edge of the arena.
No, these guys are in great shape. That is 2 seconds left. And on points, Shadow Cartel ekes it out ahead of Gorgon Empire.
Grabbing victory from the jaws. Rapidly closing jaws of defeat, Shadow Cartel.
I can clearly declare the hero of this match is Nasty Spanker.
One of the best pilot names in EVE. One of the best pilots in EVE, as evidenced by this tournament. That has been an amazing match. With that, we will send you back to some ads and back to the studio.
Shoot him! Pew, 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 pew! I got a kill! My Jones got me a kill!
Make sure
he's
not scrammed.
Got him. 15 seconds to make a cool ATAT. It's got to have dank content. Overused MLG mans. And MLG Daniel, wait. No profanity. How am I supposed to make an ATAT without saying fun?
I don't know what to say, really. 3 minutes till the biggest battle of our professional lives all comes down to today. Either we heal as a team or we're gonna crumble. Inch by inch, play by play, till we're finished. We're in hell right now, gentlemen. Believe me. And we can stay here, get the shit kicked out of us, or we can fight our way back into the light. I made every wrong choice a middle-aged man can make. I pissed away all my money, believe it or not. I chased off anyone who's ever loved me. And lately, I can't even stand the face I see in the mirror. You know, when you get old in life, things get taken from you. I mean, that's part of life. But you only learn that when you start losing stuff. You find out life's this game of inches. So is football. Because in either game, life or football, the margin for error is so small. I mean, one half a step too late or too early, and you don't quite make it. One half second too slow, too fast, you don't quite catch it. The inches we need are everywhere around us.
Hell yeah.
They're in every break of the game, every minute, every second. On this team, we fight for that inch. On this team, we tear ourselves and everyone else around us to pieces for that inch. We claw with our fingernails for that inch. Because we know when we add up all those inches, that's gonna make the fucking difference between winning and losing. Between living and dying. It's the guy who's willing to die who's gonna win that itch. And I know if I'm gonna have any life in it, it's because I'm still willing to fight and die for that itch. Because that's what living is. The 6 inches in front of your face. Now I can't make you do it. You gotta look at the guy next to you. Look into his eyes. Now I think you're gonna see a guy who will go that inch. You're gonna see a guy who will sacrifice himself for this team because he knows when it comes.